Hello, everyone, and welcome to MCAT's Wildlife Filmmaking Camp. These are the summer camp kids. You guys want to wave? Hey! And all week, we have been filming wildlife. On Wednesday, we went to Kate Davis's Raptors of the Rockies, where we filmed several videos and had a ton of fun. And so the videos that we're about to show you are all the videos that these kids made, and we helped them make. So here you go, and I hope that you enjoy.
In the natural habitat of the ducks.
That's great.
And here's another one going in the water. He's probably gonna go over the lake. Not really, but it looks like it.
Hello, everybody. And we are here at this little wildlife spot.
It's a tree. Let's get away with these.
Sean, I don't need your comments right now.
Yeah, I know, but there's a dog. There's one over there.
It's just trying to catch up. Look. There's the one over there on iron bar.
Oh, and right here. We have a little.
Oh,
wow.
Little
geese.
I never saw that.
Oh, yeah, he's right there. You can see him through the clearing. He's kind of camouflaged.
That one.
And we also have a duck right on here. We have a little duck again.
We have a little friend.
These ducks seem a little bit courageous to come this close.
Oh, look at that. That one has like dirt on his face.
Oh, and he's apparently eating the soggy food.
Sunny.
Also, look at this one. He kind of has his face is like a little shiny. It's like blue and green.
Hello. And hey, we see some stuff on the twig. It's very, very cool. It looks like a raven or something. You can see a little house in the background. Amazing, eh?
Thank you.
siblings on them, aren't you?
Yeah. Both siblings. Your old sibling.
Pretty antsy.
Whoa! Oh, that's cool. This is Sibley. She's a 12-year-old peregrine falcon that I bought from a breeder in Bozeman. And I raised her right here in the living room in a playpen. This is her perch where she hangs out every day. She has a building outside, of course, but she is remarkable in that in her 12 years, she's done over 500 education programs. Plus she flies starting in late August until the middle of March, nearly every day. And many days it's exercise, but a lot of days it's hunting. And what she likes to do is duck hunt. She is an education bird that also does, that I use in the sport of falconry. And basically, I just like to watch her fly around. It's not really the hunting part, it's the flying part. And she gets up about, 500 to 800 feet, and will follow me. Sometimes as close as like 300 feet, sometimes right over ponds, but the reason she comes back is that she's a little bit hungry. You can see she's hungry now. She's eating a quail. And the other reason is she's an imprint, or she thinks I'm her mom or her sister or her mate. So basically she'll come back for that reason. How fast does a peregrine go? They have done studies with trained birds, they've got them up to over 200 miles an hour. That you're really risking injury at that speed. I've seen her go well over 100. And she's of course hitting birds in the air. She's not hitting squirrels on the ground. She's hunted lots and lots of ducks. Pheasants, she kind of got spooked. She kind of got spooked by pheasants. She did a half-hour show for Ducks Unlimited. She did a show for BBC in which we put her in the Tower of Power at the university and had her fly straight up 28 feet. Let's see, she's been in a bunch of calendars. She's been in the Christmas card for the Peregrine Fund. Is it the Christmas card something? She was in there. She's very photogenic. Probably the most photographed peregrine falcon that ever lived. Look, Sib. You can just leave her here. I don't know what else she needs, but it's a good comparison. Is Sibley my favorite? Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. Sibley's 12 years old. This will be her 13th year of hunting. And our season starts on September 1st, and it goes for 7 months. The reason you don't fly her in the summer is she's molting. So let's look at some of these feathers. Some of these feathers are coming in, and the real black ones are the new ones. These ones are the old ones. And they get worn, they get faded, and then they replace them every year. She'll lose almost every feather. This over the summer. It takes her about 6-7 months to molt, and I start flying her before she's finished molting. But right now I'm giving her as much food as she wants, so these feathers grow in nice and strong. She's beautiful. She's very smart. So anyway, falcons are actually, they've reclassified them and put them in a super order with the parrots and perching birds. They're separate from hawks now, so they're in their own little group.
Shark. So she's like a shark stoof.
She's like a shark.
It's really funny. She's you walk towards her and she tells me like back off.
Sorry.
Yikes. Yeah, look. Oh, Shell wears the same feather.
She wears the same feather on either side the same day. So she's always biosymmetrical. She can always fly.
I got them.
There's more in there.
I'm getting them.
There's more in there. There's 18 of them.
There goes one.
No, there's one more.
Here, take your. Today, this is the other pygmy owl. His name is iPod. And this owl is also nocturnal, and he's very, very small. Pygmy owls are usually very small.
They eat meat, they're a raptor, just like the last one we did over there.
And what kind of owls are these?
Great horned owls. I believe the female one is in the back, or it might be the other way around, actually. And as you can see, they love to stare.
And they love being on TV.
Maybe.
Look at the female in the back. She's like...
And what do you guys know about owls?
Well, they're nocturnal, raptors, basic procedure. And these guys, they don't have horns, it's just a huge lump of feathers.
Yeah. And their ears, right? They have big ears.
And these are some kind of hawks, I don't remember. They are, like I said in the last one, they're predators. They are not nocturnal. They eat bugs, other birds. There are two.
The red tail hawk.
She's listening to us. She can see us, but she can't see details. And she can stand on a perch for long periods and listen to us. Make out our shapes.
Yeah, we should just do a random film.
We want to do a random film.
I
want to get one of the movies, like, we should have.
I don't want any trouble.
Well, we do want trouble!
I'm just bored.
Prepare to face my fire with a doom!
I got your back!
Get you!
Oh, you liar!
Minions, you're finally useful for something!
Hey! You saved my kitten's back, now pay up!
Hello, do you want to get fire whipped?
Hey! My source of power! I'll have my revenge!
We got the source of your power.
That guy cares.
We took his source of power.
Preparing the execution.
Executing is ready.
Save me.
I got you. And you then.
Yeah.
I'm here to save you.
I'm still preparing.
Just do backfire.
Cutting fire.
You said it.
That was a close one.
It was.
Ah, roll!
Been here for 5 years. This is their fourth year with chicks. They have three chicks this year. And they're gonna fledge any day, like probably today, like maybe even right now. So this male right now, he's acting like he's hiding underneath those limbs. It's because the ospreys absolutely cannot fly by. So our eagle, Sunny, we don't know how old he is. He came in as an adult. They have a white head at 6 years old, so he's over six. Max, the golden eagle, is our oldest. He's 26. And then Nigel, we got when he was four, and he's 20. And he's been a great program bird. Max has brain damage due to starvation, probably. He's been in captivity all his life. And Nigel was shot. And Sonny, the bald eagle, just came in missing a wingtip, and we don't know exactly what happened to him. They're out in the elements. They have a lot of stimulus. They have roommates, and you know, they have their surroundings to enjoy. And truly, Nigel will leave the property maybe 10 times a year. The other two don't at all. And so they just you know, go from their shelters when the weather's bad out into their favorite perches. They're fed every day. They eat squirrels and heart meat and game meat. And so they can roughly double their lifespan that they would have in the wild. So they'll be around for a while. There's no retiring from this job.
True facts about the Oplomato falcon. Oplomato means lead-colored, and in Latin, it means the prettiest bird I've ever seen. Only by me, of course. The body length of the Oplomato falcon is 14 to 18 inches. The average Oplomato weight is 6 to 14 ounces. The average wingspan of an Oplomato falcon is normally 2.5 feet to 3 feet. The lifespan of an Oplomato falcon is 20 years within captivity and 12 years within the wild. When breeding season comes around, the male and female court each other through spectacular aerial displays, loud calls, quiet e-chirps, and food exchanges. Like most falcons, Oplomato falcons don't build their own nests. They take abandoned ones from other birds. Normally, the female Oplomato falcon will lay 1 to 3 eggs. After about 5 weeks, the Oplomato eggs will hatch. It will take 40 days for them to grow up. Oplomato falcons hunt together as pairs or family groups to pursue and flush out their prey. Their diet consists of rodents, birds, and reptiles. And now for something different. Kate Davis talking about Sonora, the Oplomato falcon.
I got her from the Peregrine Fund. They were breeding him and releasing him for the last 20 years, and the reintroduction program really didn't work. There were some nests in Texas right now, but they quit their breeding program. I got her 2 years ago, and she's pretty much the last Oplomato that they bred. I got her when she was 17 days old and raised her in the house. So it's the northern subspecies that's endangered. I used to fly her in falconry, and I don't do that anymore. She's 2 right now. She's exactly 2 right now.
So today's her birthday?
Pretty much, right? Exactly.
Happy birthday, Sonora!
I think so, really, to be honest. And I went over to the Peregrine Fund and picked her up in the breeding facility, and they pushed her over, and I put her in this laundry basket and drove all the way back. I raised her right here in a playpen. This is her favorite toy, this little lizard, which is what they would eat in the wild. And she's chewed the toes off somehow. But she stands right here on this all day. She's guarding her food now. But she stands here all day, and I have newspaper underneath.
Around.
Yeah.
Thanks to Kate Davis for letting us film and see this amazing bird.
And this is my daily walk.
True facts about the red-tailed hawk. The average height of a female red-tailed hawk is 19 inches to 25 inches. The average wingspan of a red-tailed hawk is 44 inches to 52 inches. The average weight of a red-tailed hawk is 31 ounces to 51 ounces. The red-tailed hawk is the second largest buteo hawk in North America, after ferruginous hawk. Courting red-tailed hawks put on a display in which they soar in wide circles at a great height. The male dives steeply, then shoots up at an angle nearly as steep. After several of these swoops on one another, clasp talons and plummet in spirals towards the ground before pulling away. Red-tailed hawks normally lay 1 to 5 eggs. The red-tailed hawk's eggs normally hatch after 28 to 35 days.
When I turn her glove, she's going to open her wings. Are you ready?
Yeah. She's so pretty.
Thanks to Kate Davis for allowing us to see Elisa, the beautiful red-tailed hawk.
Fight!
And cut.
Sorry, I ran in front of the
mic. Catch it 3 feet over my head. Get her chest. Come on. 3 feet over my head. Oh!
Oh, she got it.
Gotcha.
You gotta be careful, Thomas. I poop on you.
Every day, and she's a desert bird, so she has a heated perch, a heat lamp, and I put, believe it or not, clear shower curtains so she can get sun but doesn't get the wind. It gets her out of her. She's on her own wind. 20 below, she's fine.
Wow. Yeah. That's awesome.
She's like, hey,
fine!
And that one was hit, they both were hit by cars, they both had broken wings when they were very young. So most Raptors die their first year. That's just a fact. It's just a fact. They have to catch, now does the prey want to get caught? No. So they have a hard time. They have to catch stuff that doesn't want to get caught. They don't just go get 3 for $1 hot dogs. They're homeless, right? And they don't just, you know, eat apples, you know, in the orchard or something like that. They have to catch stuff that's trying to get away. So most of them die. And almost every bird here came as a young bird that made a mistake or would have died, but instead his education. I've done 1,555 programs with these birds over the years. Not this year, okay? The apple motto falcon, this is an endangered subspecies. The Peregrine Fund was releasing them in Texas, and it just didn't work. There's a drought, there's no prey items for them, and the hawks, the minute they let them go, they get mad. So they quit their breeding program. They had 30 breeding pairs. That's the last one. The last one. They were to me, and they go, here's the luckiest aplomato in the world. And aplomato means lead-colored in Spanish. So she has a what color is lead?
Gray.
She's got a gray back. Anyway, this is where I do all my work. This is where I've written 5 books. And I wanted to write books ever since I was a kid. This is the first book. It's out of print. It's a kid's book on called Raptors of the Rockies. And I wrote this book, Falcons in North America.
Ooh, I guess you have
this is my favorite.
Yeah, I read that one.
The entire time I wrote that book, I had a peregrine falcon standing on this perch. So the next book I wrote was this one. It's called Raptors of the West. This won the National Outdoor Book Award. I sold so many of these that I bought that camera and that lens. Okay? You want to know how much the lens cost, probably? $7,000. Okay? Then I wrote this book. This is about a bald eagle nest that's in between East Missoula and Bonner. That had 4 chicks. I got that picture the first day. 5 minutes. I was on the railroad tracks and I got that picture. I thought, this is going to be easy. No, it wasn't. I stood on the railroad tracks for 4 months.
Okay? Straight, you guys. 4 months straight.
I was there.
No sleep.
The trains, I mean, they quit honking at me. I was there all the time. And this is 40 minutes from right here. Every time I was there, I could stand there for 2 or 3 hours and not take a picture and go, I cannot believe I'm doing this. And every time I wasn't there, I'm thinking, I should be there. This drove me crazy, okay? The nest that you saw through the scope is 7 minutes away, and that's what all these pictures, that picture right there is the best one I've ever taken. The male landing next to the female, right at the top of that tree we were looking at, 7 minutes away. I take my dogs, I'm down there for 2 to 3 hours a night. It is fun as heck. Second, I wrote this book. This book just came out last October, Kestrel Pint-Sized Predator. And I kind of camped out at 4 kestrel nests, one in a box and the rest in natural cavities. And I wrote this book, and the final thing is about kestrels in the 21st century. We're lucky to have them here. They don't have them on the East Coast anymore.
So sad.
I know it.
It seems like they're really down too, right here.
So this is how I shoot the eagle pictures that are on Facebook every day.
Yeah.
Down at the river on a tripod, on a Manfrotto video panning head, tripod head. I put this in, I put it on, I lock in, I shoot 2,500th of a second, 400 ASA or ISO I should say, and I'm shooting as open as I can, so it's usually only 7 or, this means nothing to me.
That's a crane.
All right. And we're back. I hope
that you all enjoyed all the movies that we've made this week. We all had a lot of fun. And so there will be DVDs that will be available next week. We're going to make them for you guys, and they'll have all the videos on there. Yeah. But that was our wildlife filmmaking camp. We had a lot of fun this week. And these are our campers once again. So if everyone wants to yell and jump and wave goodbye, and come on. Woo! Goodbye! Bye! Yay! Oh, we didn't do the one we made a video about. We made a video about Scott in the background. He was like typing on the computer, and we made a missile and a kidney exploded.
A kidney exploded?
Yeah. No. No. He exploded. He was like, "We hate you."
Nice. And you guys have you guys had fun this week?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. What were your favorite things?
Making that dinosaur movie.
Colin, what was one of your favorite things this week?
The whole thing.
Milo?
Whole thing.
Okay. Moira?
Everything Leo say.
Thomas, what was one of your favorite things this week?
Do you expect me to answer this?
All right. Darren, what was one of your favorite things this week?
Editing.
Editing?
Okay.
Sarah, you?
I'm going to the Raptor Ranch.
And then Nan?
Everything.
Great. Yeah, so they loved everything. It was a great week.
Yeah, thanks for tuning in, you guys, and catch us back in 2 weeks, and we'll have our animation camp. Yeah, thanks.